Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Psychotherapy and the Highly Sensitive Person, Improving Outcomes for That Minority of People Who Are the Majority of Clients, by Elaine N. Aron. Narrated by Coleen Marlo. Preface. Infants each have a unique temperament. We know parents are not imagining things when they say, "He's such an easy baby," or "She's more active than her brother was." Obviously, infants grow into adults, keeping their temperament. But when we see an adult patient, it is far more difficult to sort out what is nature and what is nurture. We know the basic traits are still there and deserve to be considered as an unchanging substrate of patients. But how can we help them have a good relationship with their genetic makeup, especially when it means being highly sensitive? High sensitivity, as defined in my research, is found in about 20% of the population, studying primates. So no doubt some of your friends and family members are highly sensitive as well as a large percentage of your patients. They are observant of subtleties and bothered more than others by high levels of stimulation, such as loud noise, places like malls, extreme temperatures, or a long day of sightseeing. They have strong emotional responses and need more downtime. They are usually thoughtful and observant. About 70% are introverts, and in certain ways may seem more vulnerable, yet thrive in their own way. Why a new trait now? This trait is not new, of course. It is found in both humans and animals, so it has been around a long time. It has been given a variety of names, depending on the focus of the research in which it has been studied. For example, in infants, low sensory threshold, slow to warm up, affective negativity, inhibitedness, differential susceptibility to both positive and negative environments, psychobiological reactivity, biological sensitivity to context. Sensitivity seems to provide an umbrella that captures well the underlying innate survival strategy beyond the trait, a tendency found in the immune system as well as the central nervous system, not only in humans, but also in over 100 animal species, from fruit flies and fish to canines and rhesus monkeys. This strategy allows one to process information thoroughly before responding. How does this trait relate to psychotherapy? Although this trait is found in 20% of the population, the actual occurrence is probably closer to 50% of patients in most practices. Individuals display this trait mainly if they had a troubled childhood, which makes them more prone than non-sensitive persons to depression, anxiety, and shyness, although those who had good childhoods do not display these problems any more than non-sensitive persons. Indeed, there is considerable evidence that sensitive children benefit more than other children from good childhoods. This is one of many reasons not to think of this trait as a disorder, and why the title of this book is Psychotherapy and the Highly Sensitive Person, not for. An equally important reason so many highly sensitive people seek therapy is because they believe they have a disorder even if they do not. They are a poorly understood minority and they do not even understand themselves, so they come seeking an explanation for why they seem to be so different. They are also more likely to come to treatment and want more sessions than other patients because they are more open and interested in things psychological, more aware of symptoms and their long-term consequences, and better able to see and overcome their initial resistance. They also need to stay longer because it takes more time to establish trust with them, and they need to understand and adapt to their trait as well as work on their presenting problem. They also gain more if they process their therapy experience longer, and probably they enjoy it more. Overall, needing and appreciating more and longer treatment, they will be a higher percentage of a general patient population at a given time. With so many sensitive patients coming to counselors for so many reasons, it is crucial that we know how to distinguish sensitivity from the many disorders that it could be mistaken for. At the same time, we need to appreciate that sensitivity is often present along with other problems and disorders. So we need to know how those problems look different in sensitive patients and how understanding their sensitivity can improve our work with them. The purpose of this book is to clarify these issues while suggesting ways you can adapt to these patients' needs. What will I gain from this book? First, you will receive a speedy yet thorough education about high sensitivity. Although this book is intended to be a solid academic and professional book, it is written to save you time, with summaries at the beginning and end of each chapter and bottom-line summaries of each section. There are also case illustrations and simple dialogues throughout. The first chapter gives you a feel for the main characteristics and the scientific research behind the trait. There is a fuller description of the research in Appendix C. And the second chapter helps you with the central task of recognizing when someone who comes from counseling is highly sensitive. The third, fourth, and fifth chapters provide ways to help these patients with their most typical problems and to adapt your work together so you have the best outcome possible. The sixth, seventh, and eighth chapters focus on relationships and work, with the final chapter's focus on helping you identify sensitivity amid the vast array of other possible personality variations, including variations among the highly sensitive. More generally, from this book you will gain the ability to improve greatly the quality of life of all the sensitive patients in your present and future practice. You will be able to inform them about their trait, validate it, and thereby permanently improve their self-esteem, while helping them separate their innate temperament from the rest of what is going on for them. They will learn from you the advantages of this trait and how to handle what could become disadvantages. With many, your understanding of this core trait, so often overlooked or misunderstood by other professionals, will be the basis of their trust in you and the success of your other treatment goals. Perhaps your most satisfying gain will be in seeing many of these patients benefit more than others from your psychotherapeutic efforts. As I stated previously, there is a growing body of research showing that sensitive children have a biological sensitivity to context that allows them to derive more from other children from a supportive, enriching environment. Although they are sensitive to negative environments, children with a heightened sensitivity to psychosocial processes might also be better able to notice when social cues denote encouragement and acceptance. It seems very likely that excellent psychotherapy would have the same differentially positive effects on sensitive adults, helping them turn vulnerability into a susceptibility to the good all around them. Still, isn't this hypersensitivity an impairment? The question naturally persists, largely because the mentioned research on the normalness and benefits of the trait is not yet well known. Plus, therapists do not see a cross-section of all sensitive persons because those raised in good environments are often adapting well, blending in, and unobtrusively selecting to place themselves in the situations in which they perform best and avoiding the others. You hardly notice them, even if you know them well. They are not the ones you think of when you think of high sensitivity. On the other hand, due to their heightened vulnerability, there are more sensitive persons than others experiencing psychological distress, and these sensitive individuals stand out. Suffering and sensitivity are paired in our minds. Even among non-patients, we tend to notice sensitive people only when their feelings are being too easily hurt or too bothered by a little bit of noise. Further, being a minority, they are not normal in the sense of being like most people and like most therapists. The highly sensitive truly are different. On the HSP scale, there are people who answer yes to every question and those who answer no to all of them. That is a considerable range in behavior, but it is all normal. Further confusion arises because high trait sensitivity can resemble certain disorders. For example, the highly sensitive have stronger emotional reactions, which could be mistaken for cyclothymia, and it does become that in some sensitive people. Their desire to pause to check before entering a novel situation can appear to be or become shyness. Their preference to revise cognition maps after a failure rather than plunging immediately ahead again could be mistaken for compulsiveness. Or their desire to consider all the consequences of a course of action could appear to be chronic anxiety. And again, some sensitive people do develop these disorders. Above all, the potential for becoming overstimulated that accompanies the trait can lead to overarousal in the very situations most important to anyone, and overarousal or underarousal in anyone leads to discomfort and poor performance in the short run and reduced self-esteem and risk-taking in the long run. Hence, if one confuses some natural consequences of the trait with the trait itself, it can seem to be nothing but a disorder or syndrome. Yet the trait itself is not an impairment. Indeed, it can yield rich benefits. Is this like being born shy? Sensitivity gives a more accurate sense of what underlies behaviors we label as shy, anxious, inhibited, reactive, neurotic, or withdrawn. These terms are applied after observing individuals, especially children and animals, who are not doing anything unusual that can be seen, so we try to hypothesize the cause of this inaction. But terms like shy do not cover all the possibilities. Strictly speaking, shy means fearing social judgment. How can we be certain that a child who hesitates before entering a classroom is afraid? The term high sensitivity comes closer to explaining a strategy of learning about one's environment through observing rather than exploring, while allowing for the fact that if a sensitive child's learning has been that rejection is likely to occur after entering a classroom, that child is more likely to become shy. The term sensitive is also hopefully less negative, or rather has at least as many positive as negative implications. After all, the term for a trait does determine how we view it, and there are no truly neutral terms. For example, spontaneity as a trait is positively viewed, whereas impulsivity is negatively viewed. Likewise with persistence versus stubbornness or extroversion versus lacking boundaries. In the case of this trait, most terms for it focus on what it sometimes but not always leads to. Social withdrawal, fear, rumination, low self-esteem, shyness, and pessimism. In fact, none of these are inherent results of sensitivity, but they can arise through an interaction of the innate trait with various life experiences and difficulties. Since there are many sensitive persons without these negative characteristics, using these negative terms mislabels them in a way that harms these individuals, misdirects researchers, and confuses clinicians. Isn't this actually introversion? Sensitivity and introversion are the same in the way that Carl Jung first used the terms, a preference to understand an experience subjectively, through comparison with other experiences, rather than explore its objective qualities. Also, research on introversion repeatedly finds that introverts are more sensitive in many senses than extroverts. But all of us, even Jung, then proceed to talk as if all introversion were social introversion. Although roughly 70% of sensitive persons are social introverts, 30% are actually social extroverts who do reflect considerably on their experiences and need more downtime than other extroverts in order to do this. They would be left out by equating sensitivity with introversion, and this is a group that especially needs to be understood. Sensitivity appears to be more fundamental and innate, while introversion results from various causes, sensitivity being only one. Introversion and extroversion are still useful terms, but when sensitive patients are called sensitive, their therapists grasp a little better their underlying makeup. Equally important, patients feel more understood and helped because they recognize more of their experiences in this term, beyond their social behaviors. Why would therapy need to be any different for sensitive persons? It begins in a therapist's waiting room and office. Sensitive persons react strongly to their environment, and you can easily make a room comfortable for them if you realize this. Their initial session will be different. They will be more nervous than others would be, which can be wrongly interpreted or heightened in ways that make them suffer unnecessarily. As therapy progresses, these patients will benefit most from being treated gently and not being overstimulated. No one learns well when over-aroused. With these patients, that happens more easily, so you need to adjust your style to them. They are also more sensitive to criticism and prone to shame. These reactions can be avoided by stating whatever you need to say in a softer way than you might with others. These are only a few ways. Isn't this more of a popular self-help idea? This subject first appeared in my book for the layperson, The Highly Sensitive Person, which was published in 1996 before the first empirical research appeared in 1997. That book received considerable public attention, but for me it has been first and foremost a research topic. I never intended to write a popular book on sensitivity or anything else, but at the time that I began the research, I was affiliated with the University of California at Santa Cruz, and they wrote a press release about it that was featured in the Sunday section of the local newspaper. Although only my name appeared in print, in the next 2 weeks, hundreds of people had located me, calling or writing and wanting to know more. I agreed to give a talk at the public library, and the crowd was standing room only. Afterward, There were many requests for some sort of course on the subject. I had no idea what to teach beyond what I had already reported at the library, but I agreed to provide a small course and found myself listening more than teaching as a few dozen sensitive persons compared notes about how they managed their lives. Soon I had pages of coping strategies that I shared during three more courses. However, I was definitely not interested in a career of giving self-help seminars, so it seemed best to meet the obvious need for this information by writing a book. Indeed, it seemed like almost an ethical obligation, given the strength of interest and of the as-yet-unpublished research. When the book became a bestseller, there were many more opportunities to reach sensitive people and help them through The Highly Sensitive Person's Workbook, The Highly Sensitive Person in Love, a natural topic given that my husband and I have collaborated for years on research on attraction and closeness, and The Highly Sensitive Child. The last seemed necessary as I further explored the statistical interaction of a poor home environment and sensitivity leading to adult anxiety, depression, and shyness. Providing the general public with the information they need has left me little time to add to the research or attend conferences to discuss it, which would have led to more studies by others and the critical mass being achieved that makes an idea well known in academic circles. Hence, some may still see it as not a serious topic within academic psychology. What about the author? I am highly sensitive myself, and while my own sensitivity could seem to threaten my objectivity, it does mean that I know the trait from the inside, which has been useful given that sensitivity involves so much non-observable behavior. Further, being a psychotherapist who gradually became a specialist in treating sensitive patients, I have thousands of hours of clinical experience working with this group. I also have as many hours teaching, interviewing, and consulting with a larger non-clinical population of highly sensitive persons, allowing me to compare the two. I have tried to use all of this material as objectively as possible, and being a skeptical type myself, there is an equal chance that I have been overly conservative. Using this book. The ideas presented in this book should be equally useful, whatever your theoretical orientation. I have tried to avoid advocating a particular overall approach, even if my own approach may show through at times. Its suggestions could become homework in brief cognitive behavioral therapy, or insights gradually gained for use in longer-term psychodynamic work. Illustrations are more often of complicated long-term patients, assuming you do not need as many examples of working with those only needing counseling about the trait. The cases are composites, and thus names are pseudonyms. I have wondered if this solution is quite right, given that a composite creates a person who might never exist. But perhaps all clinical descriptions have that problem. Please notice the appendices. While at first it seemed sensible to begin with the research, it also felt wrong to force readers at the outset to digest several chapters of what might not interest them. Therefore, the details of the research are presented in Appendix C. Chapter 2 on assessment seemed to require some mention of the American Psychiatric Association's Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, DSM, categories, how sensitivity might be mistaken for various disorders, and how a patient's sensitivity might change the look of some disorders. But it too seemed likely to be a burdensome beginning, so that material became Appendix B. Terminology. High sensitivity. Sensitivity and sensory processing sensitivity are used interchangeably. However, sensitive person refers to someone who is part of the group of all highly sensitive persons in the general population, and sensitive patient refers to someone in the subset of those who seek psychotherapy. That distinction is important. My choice of patient, more often than client, is best explained by the reflections of Pat Denning in her preface to Practicing Harm Reduction Psychotherapy. When I call someone my patient, I feel a different, more profound responsibility in my role as therapist. I am aware that this person has come to me in pain and often with a large amount of fear. I promise to offer myself as an anchor and an active helper, realizing her vulnerability and taking care not to use it to demean her or gain control over her life. Somehow for me, the word client does not convey this sense of awesome responsibility, respect, and intimacy. Chapter 1. Highly Sensitive Patients. Who they are, who they aren't, and why it matters. I believe in aristocracy, though if that is the right word, and if a Democrat may use it. Not an aristocracy of power, but of the sensitive, the considerate. Its members are to be found in all nations and classes, and all through the ages there is a secret understanding between them when they meet. They represent the true human tradition, the one permanent victory of our queer race over cruelty and chaos. Thousands of them perish in obscurity. A few are great names. They are sensitive for others as well as themselves, considerate without being fussy. Their pluck is not swankiness, but the power to endure. E.M. Forster, What I Believe, in Two Cheers for Democracy. This chapter provides an understanding of the highly sensitive person who is not necessarily a patient before turning to those who are. It provides a definition of high sensitivity, differentiates it from disorders requiring treatment, and compares it to other well-known personality traits. There is a list of characteristics of sensitive persons, and finally, a discussion of the research indicating that sensitive persons with difficult childhoods do indeed evidence more vulnerability than others to depression, anxiety, and shyness. I've always been shy. Everybody says I'm way too sensitive. I don't get it. There are people with far worse childhoods and they don't need therapy. They aren't depressed and anxious. Therapists often hear these statements in their first session with a patient, and they consider various hypotheses about the underlying cause. Is the shyness enough to be social phobia? Is too sensitive a sign of personality disorder? Why is this person suffering so much, given his or her history? Many clinicians have applied the term sensitive to a patient or seen the word casually used in the literature. For example, individuals who are overstimulated by parental needs or who are especially sensitive by nature may perceive both pain and pleasure intensely. And on the first page of the first chapter of The Inner World of Trauma, Donald Kalst wrote, "In most cases, these patients were extremely bright, sensitive individuals who had suffered on account of this very sensitivity some acute or cumulative emotional trauma in early life." Yet these authors, like most clinicians, do not venture to define the term. Definition and prevalence. Sensitivity, high sensitivity, and sensory processing sensitivity are terms used in this book to identify a single innate temperament trait expressed as an awareness of subtleties and stimuli, as well as a potential to be overwhelmed by too much stimuli. This enhanced perception is not a quality of the sense organs, but rather of a brain exhibiting a strategy of processing information especially deeply. Hence, the observable behaviors that result from this strategy are quite varied, as you can see from the range of items on the HSP scale, which is presented in Appendix A. Sensitivity is found in about 15 to 20% of the population. Interestingly, it has been found in about the same percentage in most animals as well, from fruit flies to primates, although its genetic form and expression, of course, vary with the species. Its distribution is bimodal rather than normal. That is, individuals tend to have the trait or do not have it. There are not many in the middle. Biologists now refer to two general strategies in animals, giving rise to two innate personality types with various names, such as bold versus shy, hawk versus dove. The former are usually the majority. Their strategy is to move quickly and forcefully, if necessary, toward feeding and mating opportunities without much prior observation of the situation. Compared to the more impulsive or bold 80%, the sensitive minority evolved a survival approach of avoiding risks by carefully observing the subtleties in a situation before acting. Both strategies, think first and act now, can be successful, depending on conditions in the environment. In humans, the more sensitive strategy of scanning the environment and attending to details of stimulation has been observed in functional magnetic resonance imaging, and more generally in thinking and feeling before and during a behavior. This strategy allows for a greater awareness of subtleties and consequences. This in turn leads, for example, to high levels of conscientiousness and creativity. On the negative side, this elaborate processing creates a greater potential for being overstimulated and troubled by stressful life events. As for gender, there are as many sensitive men as women born. And while perhaps the presence of testosterone has some later effect, for the most part, they experience sensitivity differently according to the culture in which they live. If the culture disapproves of a man being sensitive, these men generally learn to cover up their sensitivity in order to appear more like a typical male. On the HSP scale, Appendix A, they tend to score a bit lower, even though gender-biased items have been removed from the scale. For example, originally there was a question on the scale about crying easily, which many respondents assented to. But men did so much less. In fact, sensitive men were actually a little less likely than other men to say they cry easily. Yet eliminating items like this did not change the overall effect of gender, which was that men scored lower. This is probably due to their overall impression of the scale. Sensitive men definitely have different issues than sensitive women, and overall probably face larger problems. The issues for both genders are discussed more in Chapter 5. Bottom line, sensitivity is an innate trait found in 20% of humans, and in most animals as well. It seems to result from a strategy of processing information carefully before acting, and results in an awareness of subtleties, but also in being easily overstimulated. There are as many sensitive men as women, but the men hide this trait more and usually have more difficulties with it. Sensitivity in clinical practice. High sensitivity is a normal variation in innate temperament. It has a high prevalence and bestows many benefits. It is not a diagnostic category. Rather, it is orthogonal to mental disorder. Some sensitive persons have diagnosable disorders, as do some non-sensitive persons. Most do not, just as most non-sensitive persons do not. The highly sensitive have been found, however, to be more vulnerable to depression, anxiety, and shyness if they have had difficult childhoods. But with a good enough childhood, evidence is no more indicative of this trait than in non-sensitive persons. Indeed, as mentioned in the preface, sensitive children appear to benefit more than others from good childhoods. Still, many do have impairments to varying degrees, especially mood and anxiety disorders. On the other hand, you will see highly sensitive persons who have no disorder but have been diagnosed with one, and some will have a disorder but will have been misdiagnosed. You may also see a few patients who think they are highly sensitive, having read about it, and probably are not, but rather do have a disorder. Specific DSM diagnoses that might be confused with sensitivity are discussed in Appendix B. An example is autistic spectrum disorder. Sometimes it is said that the trait described here is at the high end of the spectrum. The criteria for an autism disorder, or Asperger's syndrome, however, have no overlap with high sensitivity as defined here and found in 20% of the population. Many autistic persons are distressed by high levels of specific kinds of stimulation, but they can be unfazed by other types, especially social cues. In contrast, sensitive persons can tolerate high levels of stimulation without becoming utterly confused or violent, and they use increasingly appropriate ways of reducing stimulation as they mature. Further, the sensitivity in autism is due to faculty use of sensory information, not processing it to deeper levels. Sensitive persons do not perseverate in the way that the autistic do, and they evidence high levels of empathy as well as adequate to excellent social skills, especially in familiar environments. Sensory integration problems are also confused with sensory processing sensitivity. But sensory integration dysfunction, or disorder, refers to specific soft neurological problems that usually respond well to treatment. Some sensitive persons, and indeed most sedentary people, whatever their temperament, might improve through these treatments. However, they will not eliminate the characteristics listed. An illness is something you hope to change or lessen. Although the lives of sensitive persons can improve with knowledge about their trait, and they can learn ways to adapt, no treatment will eliminate innate high sensitivity. Nor is there any reason to want to do that given its advantages in some contexts. Bottom line, high sensitivity as described in this book is not a disorder. A difference like gender and ethnicity. A better way to think of this trait is that it is a widespread individual difference, much like gender, but found in a minority of people, much like a particular ethnicity. Given that many people answer yes to every item on the HSP scale, see Appendix A, while many others answer no to every item, a case could be made that this difference is a factor at least as potent in its effect as gender and ethnicity. Further, it is a largely invisible difference, and these create unique social difficulties for those who have them. As with gender and ethnicity, there are specific problems associated with being highly sensitive, some of them due to the trait itself, such as being easily over-aroused, and some due to the culture in which it is found. For example, in China, elementary school children with the trait are popular with peers. In Canada, they are not. Thus, depending on the culture, sensitive persons may have high or low self-esteem. There are also disorders that have nothing to do with sensitivity itself, yet the trait gives the disorder a certain flavor. For example, a certain number of sensitive persons with panic disorder improve with relative ease once they understand the role of overstimulation in their symptoms, whereas panic attacks in non-sensitive persons are less likely to be resolved in this way. Bottom line, this trait has an individual difference effect similar to gender or ethnicity. Comparison to other personality traits. The HSP scale overlaps with, but is not identical to, measures of introversion, in that roughly 30% of sensitive persons are found to be extroverts. This figure depends on the measure of introversion used, as these measures in themselves do not correlate well. As for neuroticism, the correlation is generally higher. One reason is that, again, highly sensitive persons with a troubled childhood are more likely to be depressed, anxious, and shy, that is, have more negative affect, the general definition of neuroticism as a personality trait, compared to non-sensitive persons with the same level of childhood difficulties and traumas. In any random sample, some sensitive persons will have had difficult childhoods, and they raise the mean of neuroticism scores for the entire sensitive subset, unless childhood environment is statistically controlled for. Shyness shows the same pattern, but is present only if there is also negative affect. That is, sensitive persons are more likely to be shy if they had difficult childhoods, and if that resulted in high levels of negative affect. Not every sensitive person's poor childhood leads to negative affect. Shyness and negative affect are the results of unfortunate experiences, not the trait itself. Bottom line, high sensitivity is not the same as introversion, neuroticism, or shyness. A list of distinguishing characteristics. The deeper processing common to all highly sensitive persons leads to the characteristics listed. Except where indicated, this list is based on my own published data or that of others, or in some cases my extensive experience, clinically and in research interviews. No sensitive person will have all of these, but should have a broad variety of them, as opposed to having a few, only staying on the sidelines or only being conscientious, which could be due to something other than a fundamental genetic difference. Preferring to be on the sidelines in a situation for a while before entering it, and generally exploring a situation more by observing and reflecting rather than by moving about within it. Sometimes I wish people would leave me alone to sit in a corner and watch before I get involved. I like to check things out first, see what I'm getting into. Being very aware of subtleties or small changes. I notice that on your answering message you now refer to yourself as doctor. Would you prefer that I call you that? That picture, carpet, hair, style, etc., is new, isn't it? Wanting to consider every detail and possible outcome before acting. Do it once and do it right, as opposed to the majority's tendency to decide more quickly. This results, for example, in being slower than non-sensitive persons at making decisions, more aware of risks and benefits, and being seen as slow but accurate. I'm terrible at making decisions. In fact, they are slow, but their decisions are usually good. I'm a real perfectionist. Being more aware of the thoughts and emotions of others, due to gaining more information from nonverbal cues and guessing correctly because of intuiting the likely effects of a situation on others. Sometimes I feel like I can read other people's minds. I'm really affected by other people's moods. Having been harmed more by bad environments in childhood or adulthood, but possibly gaining more than others from unusually supportive environments, skilled parenting or teaching in childhood, or thoughtful management in adulthood. Acting more conscientiously due to being heavily attuned to causes and consequences, how things came to be as they are and how they will turn out, depending on what is done. They think more often, what if everybody left their trash behind? If I don't finish my work on time, I will be slowing others down. Having unusual concern about social justice and the environment, and expressing an unusual degree of compassion even in childhood. I couldn't just stand by and let that happen to her. I was trying to get others to understand about global warming for years. Being easily overstimulated and hence easily overaroused. For anyone, the more stimulation, the more arousal, and overarousal leads to poorer performance for anyone. But sensitive persons are overaroused sooner by less stimulation, and so report more difficulties or failures in highly stimulating situations. For example, contests, recitals, public speaking, meeting respected strangers, being trained or under observation, timed tests, and also places that are noisy, crowded, etc. It's humiliating. I'm fine at practice, but terrible at the meets. I just can't take tests. Being gifted, artistic, or passionate about the arts. I've been crazy about the opera since I was 5 and first heard one on the radio. Having a strong interest in spirituality and often involved in a specific practice. Prayer is essential to my life. I'm a Buddhist. I meditate every day. Reporting a greater emotional reaction to events that evoke similar emotions in others, but less so. I cry at the drop of a hat. Everybody was upset, but I was devastated. Noticing unusual distress due to change. I had no idea moving would be so upsetting. I'm really having trouble adjusting to the seemingly small change in my life. Reporting unusually vivid dreams if asked. I always dream in color. My dreams seem to go on forever with a lot of details. Recalling any of these characteristics occurring first in childhood. Everyone said I was really sensitive. I liked to hide under tables and bushes or in closets and just listen to what was going on. Complaining about overstimulating or unaesthetic environments. I can't stand fluorescent lights. I had to move twice before I found a quiet apartment. Sensitive adolescents seem to tolerate loud music, crowds, and multitasking better, but this changes in the late 20s. Having physical sensitivities, faster startle response, more reactive immune system, for example, more contact allergies, and greater sensitivity to pain, stimulus, for example, caffeine, and most medications. I can't drink coffee, it makes me too nervous. My doctor finds it hard to believe that I can notice anything from such a low dose, but I do, and if I take more, I have all sorts of side effects. Speaking in a considerate, sometimes indirect way. Dropping hints. Does it seem warm in here to you? I suggested to him that maybe we should eat out. I was too tired to cook. Finding that nature has an unusually healing, calming effect, or being more moved by its beauty. Fond of animals, plants, and being near or in water. The role of their greater emotionality. One reason sensitive patients are so interesting and challenging to work with, and so prone to misdiagnosis, is that all sensitive persons react more deeply, albeit normally, to a given emotion-generating situation. It is a point not directly represented on the questionnaire, partly to avoid gender bias. If a preference to process information more deeply is the underlying reason that causes the various behaviors of the highly sensitive, how does this relate to stronger emotional reactions? One might expect that this reflecting would have a calming effect, but in fact, sensory processing sensitivity necessarily involves greater emotionality, for at least two reasons. First, emotion drives cognitive processing, since nothing is processed for long without an emotional evaluation that it is important or interesting. Second, processing drives emotion, in that the longer something is processed that has emotional meaning, the more emotion it will create. This greater emotionality is related to the interaction I already described, that sensitive people who have had a troubled childhood are more vulnerable to depression, anxiety, and shyness than non-sensitive persons with the same level of distress. However, the highly sensitive are also more prone than others to have strong positive emotions, such as responding to rewards. To term this trait an innate high vulnerability or proneness to negative affect, or in that sense, neuroticism, would be as narrow a definition as using skin cancer prone as the only term for being fair-skinned. However, it remains the case that highly sensitive people have stronger emotional reactions, a significant factor for psychotherapists to keep in mind. A mild criticism can induce shame. Mild praise can produce euphoria or possibly a misunderstanding of your feelings. Bottom line, the highly sensitive have stronger affects, both positive and negative. What is not typical of the highly sensitive? It is also helpful to think about how people present who are not highly sensitive. Given that these are the majority of people, much can be ascertained simply by remembering what most people enjoy or are not bothered by. They are not usually bothered by noise, visual clutter, sudden change, or other aspects of an environment or experience that would be overstimulating to a sensitive person. The acceptable level of stimulation in work environments and the pleasurable level of it in recreational environments and the media evidence this very well. The non-sensitive majority mostly enjoy the rapidly shifting visual stimulation of video games, television ads, and action movies. They like street fairs, major sporting events, and shopping malls during the holidays. Many enjoy horror movies, dangerous sports, and watching dramas involving shocking violence. Nor do they ponder the future overly much until the consequences of some action are pointed out to them or become costly. For example, a large number of people fail to be tested for prostate, colon, and breast cancer. Again, only judging from what is common behavior, the majority take risks with less extensive preparation. I just never expected that to happen. The highly sensitive do take risks, but carefully. For example, in a dangerous sport, they tend to be experts on safety and are much less likely to be injured. If they fail at something, they want to try again immediately rather than reflecting on their error and changing strategies as the minority do. The majority temperament enjoys all forms of gambling. They are less affected by actual or imagined financial or other loss or by making a mistake. They are less emotionally reactive generally. Yet they may show their emotions more, such as expressing anger about the service they are receiving, even though the public expression of anger is usually socially risky and highly stimulating. It is also normal for most persons most of the time to speak in a direct manner, with less concern about how their tone or word choice could affect the listener because they expect others to be like them, relatively imperturbable. Many people are fond of nature, and many find comfort there. But the non-sensitive tend to see it more as a place to pursue activities and are less concerned by the suffering of animals other than their own pets. They may practice religion, but question it less. Relatively fewer are preoccupied by spiritual matters, philosophy, or the meaning of life. But let's return to gaining a feeling for highly sensitive people by describing one as he or she might appear in your office. Bottom line. It can be helpful to notice how sensitive patients do not resemble your other patients in that the latter are not easily overstimulated, bothered by noise or sudden change, for example, and are less likely to notice subtleties, such as changes in your office. Although the following is overgeneralizing, non-sensitive patients will be fonder of video games, crowds, team sports, and action movies, not bothered by violence, take more risks and enjoy doing so, prepare less for activities, and speak more directly, without hints. They tend to use nature for recreation more than as a place of solace, and if spiritual, have given their beliefs less thought. A case illustration. Susan, 34, is an example of a patient who mainly needed extensive help adapting her life to her sensitivity, although she might have been assessed and treated differently by someone who did not understand her trait. She was crying as soon as she sat down for our first session. She was also experiencing panicky feelings at the thought of going back to work after maternity leave, and she often imagined something happening to her 8-month-old daughter, Katie. "But mostly, I'm just overwhelmed," she sobbed. "I can't take it anymore." Then she straightened up. "But I have to, and I will, of course. Don't worry about me. I'll be okay." Her tone supported that she did not wish to upset me, rather than a sudden switch to denial. Susan had taken a new position, with a considerable raise in status and pay, but put on an open floor to encourage maximal communication with those she would manage as part of the company. For her, it allowed maximal chaos and constant observation by others while she was learning a new role. The CEO had instructed her to deliver on a shortened deadline, but right away she had seen signs that their product would not satisfy clients' needs in the long run. When she voiced her opinion in meetings, she was criticized for being a Cassandra and never signing off on anything. There were also problems with this job and having a new baby. Susan had a very long commute, meaning having to choose between less time with her daughter or less sleep. She usually chose the latter, acknowledging that she was pushing the envelope. But she knew many other women in similar positions who were living like she was, although seemingly more successful at it. Susan had earned an MBA immediately after college, but since then had changed jobs frequently. I listened carefully for signs of mania, impulsivity, or stories of real or perceived victimization. But her explanations for the changes always seemed reasonable. In one case, she was concerned about the ethics of a company's business practices. In another, she doubted the worth of the product. Mainly, she had been moving rapidly up the ladder in her field, sometimes after only a few months. She had successfully transferred her learning to whole new specialties, as she was this time. She thought her marriage was going reasonably well, except that her husband, Phil, also had a burgeoning career. When she returned to work 5 months ago, they hired a live-in nanny. They felt they had no other option now that they were both working more than full-time. Susan described her mother fondly as a loving parent who stayed home with her children, two daughters, until they were in school. Mother and daughter talked once a week by phone and now more often as they shared Katie's developmental milestones. Her mother did not like the idea of a nanny raising Katie, but she remained supportive of whatever the new family chose. As for her father, she had been his favorite. He was a successful investment banker and not as available as she would have liked, so she learned to talk with him about his work. In fact, she was an investment prodigy. Her father proudly displayed in his office a graph of her gains from the stock she had chosen and he had then bought for her. Some joked that they would rather ask Susan for tips than her father. At 12, she learned to play golf, so he could take her along when he needed to complete a foursome. Susan was somewhat conscious that her father was the reason she was in the business world herself, aiming to be a CEO someday. He was always proud of her, although even he had noticed his daughter was looking strained and wished she would slow down a little. Given this reasonably happy childhood, described with appropriate affect, I decided to focus on her sensitivity. She had read my book, so I reminded her of some of its contents. In response, she cried again as she talked about the stress she was under. Her maternal feelings were very strong and she longed to have another child, yet she loved the business world. She wanted me to explain why she could not manage the same work and family responsibilities as other women rising to the top. "Didn't you say in your book that this sensitivity makes us more creative? If I'm so creative, why can't I find solutions to all of this? Instead, I'm crying all the time. Is this really what sensitivity is about? Why didn't you say that in your book?" "I did," I said very gently. "But I think you did not want to see those parts, understandably." "Does this mean I have to stay home with Katie, like Mother did with us? I'd go crazy with boredom." I asked her to look at herself as she would someone she was managing. How was she doing? She admitted she was doing badly. "So what do you think? Does something have to change?" She agreed, but she was still firm about wanting to succeed at this job, so we focused on new strategies. She would arrange staggered work hours, arriving and leaving early, which would shorten her commute, give her some quiet time in the office so that she was not doing work at home, and would give her more time with Katie. We discussed her CEO's critical style and agreed he was a normal guy, just harried and non-sensitive. Susan decided she could discuss her working style with him, that she performed best when told she was on the right track, as she could overreact to criticism and alter too much. Also, since there was a surplus of conference rooms that had been converted from offices, she would like to convert one back, giving her space where she could concentrate on this project and consult privately with individual team members. She would withhold her skepticism about a product's design in meetings until she had convinced at least two others in private that she was right and that they should stand by her. Further, she would encourage them to make similar arguments to others so that most were in agreement with her before the meetings began. We agreed to meet in a month, as she could not afford the time to come more often. In our second session, she looked even more drawn. She had tried to implement our ideas, but now she was coming to work early and still leaving late, the result of the CEO's increasing respect for her work, which was leading to even more responsibilities. Her new private office meant she was being consulted even more. There was still too little time for Katie. I pointed out that all of this was the result of her being very good at what she does, and that her sensitivity probably played a large role in that. She was the only one at work or at home who was highly sensitive. They could work 14-hour days, and they loved her for her sensitivity in the form of creativity, conscientiousness, and enthusiasm. By the way, non-sensitive mothers hate to leave their babies too, but on that scale, you suffer more. A sensitive mother and child became the theme of that session. Katie was highly sensitive, and Susan worried that their nanny did not understand this. Phil was not helping. They want to push her when she holds back. That's exactly the wrong way to get her out there. They think Katie needs to be made to do what scares her, even when she's crying and pleading with them. I know what that feels like. Her daughter had brought us to her own childhood. Your father? As far back as I can remember, he made me face my fears. I learned to force myself for him. He loved showing me off. It was so much pressure. He taught me to play golf so I could complete a foursome. I did putt well. That was your sensitivity, wasn't it? But they called me Lost Ball Susie. Her first memory, always part of my history taking, was of hiding under a bush to evade her first haircut. She imagined it would hurt. When her father heard of that, he took her for the haircut and announced her fear to everyone present. All those loud women made a huge fuss over me, and I cried and cried. But he said I'd never make it in the world if I didn't learn to face your fears. How old were you? 3. I almost gasped. So you handle Katie's fears differently. It's not hard. She'll do anything if we take our time. Show her the ropes. But she so much wants to please her father. I'm afraid she'll just learn to endure. Like you. Learning to endure, to perform beyond your limits without protest. She brought up her desire for another child and admitted she could not do it while working at this job. But leaving it made her feel like a quitter. I find it important to support both sides of an issue like this, to keep the conflict an inner one, so I suggested that we continue to explore the pros and cons of various courses of action, and we did that for the next 2 months. Meanwhile, she was slipping further, filled with self-doubt, losing weight, feeling more anxious, having difficulty focusing, and not sleeping even when she had the time to. I explained that she was simply running out of gas, neurotransmitters. After a careful discussion and her own review of the research, she decided to try an antidepressant for 6 months. The psychiatrists to whom I refer know to begin with very low doses when prescribing for sensitive patients, as they often have more side effects or need to try several before finding the right one. She soon returned to her normal weight, cried less, and had better concentration. The underlying problem did not go away, but she could think about it more objectively. We explored much more deeply her imitation of her father's highly competitive attitudes. According to her father's books on how to succeed in the corporate world, you had to overcome all weakness in yourself and make use of the weaknesses of others. She could talk now about the darker side of that, both in him and herself. From the motto of no weakness, we hit her bedrock dislike of her sensitivity. She needed to hear many times the advantages of her trait and how others enjoyed these while criticizing what they did not like. They never realize it's a package deal. What they love about you goes along with what they would like to eliminate in you. The same sensitivity that made you good at putting and choosing stocks and makes you such a good mother also made you fail under the pressure of hitting a ball or trying to be too many things at once. Her hatred of her trait did not change immediately, but she believed she had gained enough from our work to solve this problem on my own. I could almost hear her gritting her teeth. A year later, I received an announcement of her new business, which specialized in matching new parents in demanding careers with the highest quality professional personal assistants and childcare providers. In the margin, she wrote, "I'm off the medication, and you'd be proud of me. I'm keeping this business part-time and very small for now. Our new son is due in 2 months. I'm feeling as rested and ready as I'll probably ever be. I simply love being the president of my own company. I'm sure we'll go national when I am ready." Susan's improvement. Susan was the type of sensitive patient who benefits most from grasping the full implications of her sensitivity and how it interacted with her otherwise loving, adequately functioning parents and their child-rearing philosophy. In our first session, she was highly emotional, tears and panicky feelings, so that major depression or an anxiety disorder had to be considered. Yet she seemed to be functioning well, perhaps too well, on the job. It was typical, given her good enough childhood and excellent education, that she would advance rapidly in her career, even though it may have been a poor choice. Her many job changes were also typical of sensitive persons, as I will explain in Chapter 8. Naturally, a sensitive person with so many advantages and talents would want to enjoy all the opportunities these bestowed on her: marriage, career advancement, children. This lifestyle places heavy demands on any woman, but it can become far too much for a sensitive person of either gender without better outside support. Some of the stresses of work and family were exacerbated by her trait. I had to smile at her being called a Cassandra, since that poor woman was cursed by Apollo to always know the truth and never to be believed. Sensitive people can feel that way in business meetings. Given the conflict Susan faced, it is not surprising that she disliked her sensitivity. It meant she had to give up something. She had to learn to remind herself repeatedly that her trait was, as I like to describe it, a package deal. It contributed to her wealth of opportunities, but it also restricted her. Deciding what to give up leads to inner conflict, and that was intensified by her stronger emotional response due to deeper processing of what each meant to her, now and in the future. Both choices, work or motherhood, were so desired, and giving one up felt so bad. Susan benefited from antidepressants at the point where even she could see that she needed that type of help. If I had suggested it in the first session, I am sure she would not have come for a second session. This patient grew up with no knowledge of her trait, much less help on how to live with it. Trying to raise children with normal but extreme temperament variations often leads to misery for all involved. Parents are afraid there is something wrong with either them or their children. They force too much, protect too much, or take their children for counseling or agree to medications, all of which delivers the message to children that there is something very wrong with them. These children need a goodness of fit, which does not mean having parents with the same temperament, but parents and teachers who structure a child's environment in a way that enhances the best aspects of his or her temperament. Unfortunately, sensitive children tend to be so well behaved that no attempt is made to adapt to them. They adapt to others. As adults, you as their therapist must help them create goodness of fit for themselves. These patients must develop a new set of operating instructions and do so without feeling this is mainly about their limitations. Alas, probably they will not do it until there is a physical or mental health crisis. High sensitivity and high sensation seeking. Highly sensitive persons can also be high sensation seekers. It is somewhat counterintuitive, but needs to be discussed early enough for you to recognize this important variation in the trait. Susan is an example of one. These two traits, controlled by separate pathways in the brain, are independent of each other. Thus far, it is thought that sensation seeking is caused by unusually active reward areas, which were associated more with dopamine. Sensitivity is less well understood, but is probably caused in part by greater activation in areas that encourage inhibition of action along with alert attention, a pattern associated with low serotonin, creating ideal conditions for processing information more deeply. Therefore, the proper interpretation of high sensitivity is not an avoidance of stimulation, even if it leads to an avoidance of overstimulation. They actually react more to success and reward than others. Rather, the fundamental motivation created by the trait is a desire to process a situation before acting. So the opposite of being highly sensitive is being impulsive. Sensation-seeking sensitive persons are susceptible to boredom. As Susan said, she would not be a good stay-at-home mom without any other projects in her life. They will usually prefer to try new restaurants and new cuisines, not the same old haunt, unless they are feeling overstimulated. Susan liked trying new jobs. They do not like to watch the same movie twice unless it is a very good one. They may hang glide or travel to exotic places, but they are never impulsive and study the activity beforehand, doing all they can to ensure their safety. They may like novelty, but they do not like high risks or shocks. But since the dopamine-driven reward system creates a high motivation to approach or act immediately, while the purpose of the inhibition system is to do just that, to create a pause before checking things, being high on both traits can be difficult. As one person with this combination put it, it's like living with one foot on the gas, one foot on the brakes. Bottom line, the highly sensitive person can also be a high sensation seeker. They are independent traits. The opposite of sensitivity is impulsivity, not necessarily a dislike of novelty. A case illustration. Julian, 28, a freelance journalist with an otherwise normal history, came to me because of his overreaction due to witnessing the results of a terrorist bombing. He and his wife were vacationing in the area, in a region where terrorist acts were least expected, so they were the only media on the scene, and only minutes after the explosion. In the abstract, both saw it as a major journalistic opportunity. While his wife remained objective and curious, gathering details and interviewing survivors, Julian stayed very briefly. He vomited, nearly fainted, and had to retreat to a nearby hotel. He found himself crying uncontrollably for days. Images from the scene were still vivid in his memory after 6 months. He was suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder, while his high sensation-seeking, non-sensitive wife was not. Prior to this event, Julian had always thought he was perfectly suited for his career. He had loved the variety and opportunities for foreign travel, which had combined nicely with his ability to reflect, find creative angles, and write well about these. Now he doubted he was capable of any of it. He felt like a failure professionally and as a man. Although his wife insisted it was not true, he felt she had lost respect for him. It was she who had recommended he meet with me about his sensitivity, which was now obvious to her. The major part of the treatment, as with Susan, was helping him accept and appreciate the advantages of his trait. Other meanings of sensitivity not implied here. Again, sensitivity as defined here is not the same as introversion, simply because a third of the highly sensitive are extroverts, nor is it about being sensitive in the sense of caring for and being responsive to others. Most sensitive people are usually highly motivated and skilled at showing empathy. But many non-sensitive persons are equally or more motivated and successful at being sensitive in this other sense. At the same time, sensitive persons who are over-aroused can be temporarily anything but empathetic, and some with personality disorders are permanently not, at least in situations they find threatening. Sensitivity also does not refer only to being sensitive to criticism, as when someone is accused of just being too sensitive or taking things too personally. Although sensitive people as defined here do seem to process criticism more and have a stronger emotional reaction to it, that is not the essence of the trait. Bottom line, sensitivity as used here should not be equated with being caring or responsive to others or only being hypersensitive to criticism. The sensitive person versus the sensitive patient. The rest of this book will deal mostly with sensitive patients, so it bears repeating that sensitive non-patients are all around you. You may be highly sensitive yourself. The highly sensitive are usually functioning quite well. I hope I do not sound too much like a rooting section, but they often need one, because mostly they adapt and are hardly noticeable. True, they generally do not like crowds. They may ask for a quiet table in a restaurant. They need a place to live that is not too noisy. Relationships have to be deep. Work has to be meaningful, yet not entail long hours. They do not like fluorescent lights, but tolerate them for the sake of the environment. On the benefit side of the ledger, they ponder matters deeply, although they may not let on that they have strong ideas about God, death, and the universe. They may fall silent in conversations about mundane matters, but if anyone asks their opinion, they often have something worthwhile to say. They are often the ones who feel the most for what is happening on the earth and to the people in distant places. They give more money to good causes and are often active in them. Frequently, they are the ones who listen to you, remember you, and worry about you before anyone else notices a reason to. If you like massages or use alternative medicine, chances are the one treating you is highly sensitive. We sense their presence among some of the wiser, quieter political and business leaders. They are often the inventors, educators, judges, scientists, historians, and general benefactors of humankind. That does not mean they cannot be exasperating. They can be exacting, fussy, irritable when overstimulated, and critical of themselves and others equally, even though they cannot take what they dish out. They are chronically slow to decide, although their decisions are usually right. They do not like risks, so they buy more insurance and have more savings than other people think is necessary, and they want everyone they care about to do the same. They often take a break from answering the phone or email and say no to more invitations, or else they are slightly frazzled because they cannot. Their problem often is that most people like them very much. They do not always make good first impressions, but with time they become highly valued friends and group members. In short, they are people well worth helping if they ask for it. They need an upbringing and environment that suits them if they are to flourish. In an experiment that could not be done with humans, Sumi took newborn monkeys who were reactive, another term for the trait, and cross-fostered them with skilled mothers and found they grew up to be exceptionally well-adapted, usually the troop leaders. Returning to humans, some equate the highly sensitive with the highly gifted, although that does not fit with a percentage 3% of the population estimated to be gifted. Sumi's study also found that reactive monkeys raised by unskilled mothers generally had low ranks, were highly susceptible to stress, and prone to anxiety and depression, a result that mirrors those already discussed showing the interaction of sensitivity and a troubled childhood, yielding more depression, anxiety, and shyness. If so much depends on upbringing and learning, then for adult sensitive patients, it may depend in large part on you, their psychotherapist. Bottom line, highly sensitive patients are first of all highly sensitive people, capable of making valuable contributions, but that largely depends upon the nurturing they receive. A role model. My friend Jim is from a fine, upstanding, outgoing family. He was encouraged to earn his doctorate and use his learning to benefit the disadvantaged, which he does with wonderful enthusiasm. He is one of the most charming, friendly, kind, and mentally healthy persons I know. And it is also well established that he is also not highly sensitive. He never tires of talking and has a high enough pain threshold to endure all the various injuries that come with playing ultimate frisbee into one's 40s. He and his wife have two daughters. The firstborn, Betsy, is just like Jim. The second, Lily, was from the first weeks very good and quiet as long as the home was peaceful and her needs were met. Lily was also a keen observer of her world, but from Jim's point of view, a little too anxious. Still, she passed all of her early developmental milestones on time, so the family did not worry. In her second year, a worried Jim asked me to tell him more about my research. He was recognizing what I had already, that Lily was highly sensitive. Jim was relieved that she was normal, even if not like Jim's side of the family. She would have as happy a life as he, although perhaps made happy in different ways. But our discussion left Jim wondering how he could be the best possible father to his sensitive little girl. To begin, he vowed never again to interpret his daughter's behavior as any sort of flaw, disappointment to him, or reason for anyone's concern. Neither did he want his daughter to miss out on experiences that she might actually enjoy or have her grow up afraid of meeting new people. Jim became determined to introduce her to every potentially pleasurable opportunity in life, from ocean waves, tree climbing, and new foods to family reunions, soccer, and varying her clothes rather than wearing one comfortable uniform. In almost every instance, Lily initially thought these novel experiences were not such good ideas, and Jim always respected her opinion. He never forced her, although he could be very persuasive. He simply shared his view of a situation with her, the safety and pleasures involved, the similarities to other things she already liked. He would wait for that little gleam in her eye that she said she wanted to join in with the others, even if she couldn't yet. Jim always assessed these situations carefully to ensure that she would not ultimately be frightened, but rather be able to experience pleasure and success. Sometimes he held her back until she was overly ready. Above all, he kept it an internal conflict, not a conflict between him and her. He made every effort to give her time to observe, along with just a little pressure to stay in the conflict, not just back off. From his stories, I could easily imagine Jim and Lily huddled at the edge of a lake, stage, or ski slope, deep in discussion about the pros and cons of sallying forth. In spite, or because, of the fact that her father generally prevailed, Lily still prefers to have her father rather than her highly more anxious mother with her when she faces something new. And if she or anyone else comments on her quietness or hesitancy, Jim's prompt reply is, "That's just your style. Other people have different styles. But this is yours. You like to take your time and be sure." Jim also knows the part of her style is befriending anyone whom others tease, doing careful work, noticing everything going on in the family, and being the best soccer strategist in her league. In short, he is particularly proud of his highly sensitive daughter. Jim's story is here to provide you with a sense of what sensitive children need from their parents and what your sensitive adult patients need from you. Acceptance, encouragement, and pride in their success and of the best parts of their sensitivity. The importance of understanding innate sensitivity for clinical practice. No matter how excellent a person's upbringing, most sensitive patients did not have a parent like Jim. They may have been appreciated for being sensitive, intuitive, compassionate, creative, and conscientious. But rarely do others realize these admirable qualities are part of a package deal that also may include being overly fussy about socks, clothing tags, seams, and wool, overly upset by the slightest rebuke, or stubbornly cautious in new situations. Hence, as adults, they desperately need the kind of understanding Jim provides his daughter. Said more systematically, understanding this trait is clinically valuable in a number of ways. First, even when their childhood was fine, they are more likely to need help at some point in their lives with understanding why they are different from others. Often criticisms are made by people who are concerned about their unusualness. If they receive the wrong response from you, especially if it only affirms what others have said.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.